here today. I get nervous when somebody higher ranking than I am is listening to my sermons. So lead me on the vision. Thank you. Yesterday, there were 14 of us having a quiet day here in our parish hall. And the parish hall didn't look anything like the parish hall. It was filled from wall to wall, all over, with a giant labyrinth. And the women, it was all women, and we walked the labyrinth, and we prayed, and we were silent for over 3 hours. And after it was over, while we were sharing what the morning meant to us, most of us felt like it went very fast, that we were praying for 3 hours. If I were to think I'm going to go home and pray for 3 hours, that would be very long, and I would feel it. But it went so fast. I think what happened was we were carried by the power of prayer. We walked the labyrinth first as learning how to walk it. It has certain routines that the ancients have followed. And then we got into the rhythm of it. And then we walked the stations of the cross. And then we came back, and our last walking of the labyrinth, each of us held one of the figures from the nativity scene, the one that we use on Christmas Eve. And we carried the figurine into the middle of the labyrinth and set up the nativity in the center of the circle. It was a very powerful witness of the first nativity that St. Francis did in Italy, where he had the villagers represent the different animals and the people. So these prophets that are crying out to us in the readings today are crying out to us to get on your knees and say your prayers, like now. Pay attention. Jesus is coming. And when we want the mountains to be made low and the valleys to be made high, we only know one person that can do that. Who makes the mountains low and the plains high? God. People can't do that, right? But if you're like most of us, we have been rending our garments at the news this week, thinking, oh, what are we going to do? We feel so vulnerable. My parents live in the San Bernardino Mountains, and when I heard what was going on in San Bernardino, I heard the names of streets that I've been on with them. They do their business on Waterman Avenue. We've been to all these places that they mentioned, and it felt very personal to me. And I do what probably all of you do. I got addicted to my device, and I'm looking to see if there's any more updates. Do they know who did this? Do they know what the cause was or what the motive was? And I get stuck in the, oh my God, mode instead of, oh my God, and pray for justice and mercy and peace. It should be a reflex for all of us to get down on our knees and pray for justice, mercy, and peace. But when I get scared and I get caught up in the news, that's not the first thing that I do. True confession. I get addicted to the news. And what we need to do is turn off the news, unplug my device, and do what we did yesterday, which was to completely immerse ourselves in prayer. Now, when we heard the words from Baruch, beautiful words about make the way ready, for God is going to bring home all the captives, he was writing about all the people who were taken away in captivity from Jerusalem. They've been taken and held hostage in Babylon, in Egypt, and he was crying for God to raise up the valleys and lower the mountains and straighten the path so that they can come home without any struggle whatsoever. And once all of God's people had safely come home to Jerusalem, then they would show the world what a mighty God they had and how their people were the ones who worshiped the God of their hearts and of their mountain, and they were all together again. We Christians look back at these words of the prophet, and we think we're making the way ready for Jesus. So let's see, what does Jesus do when Jesus comes? How does he raise up the plains and lower the mountains? Because he does. He goes to the very poorest of the poor, and the prisoners, and the despised, and the people outside the inner circle. And he brings them up into a place of honor. And then he criticizes those who think they're in control. brings them down to their rightful humble place. So raising up the valleys and lowering the mountains has a democratic effect on the people who follow Christ. So what are we going to do about our politicians? Because I hear everybody trying to make our politicians God and saying, when is someone going to get it right? Save us. And we're praying that the politicians will rescue us and make the mountains low and the plains high. And is it politicians who are going to rescue us and make us safe? No. God alone makes us safe. Have we ever been safe? No. Have the people of God ever had it easy? No. But yet we expect for things to go better. We think we have it rougher than anybody else did. Yes, we do feel vulnerable. I felt terribly vulnerable this week. I couldn't get a hold of my parents right away. I knew in my heart that they weren't down off the mountain. They live on the top of the mountain, and they come down to go to the doctors, to go to their appointments, to go to visit their friends. But they were fine when we finally got a hold of each other. What happens when we become the people of Christ as a community is that we get down on our knees and pray for God to restore justice to the world. We pray for God to restore everyone to their rightful place. We pray for people to have mercy on all of the Muslim communities in America who are grieving that once again, violence is hijacking their faith. Are politicians going to fix this? No. Is God going to be with us, creating justice and mercy in our hearts and making us a community of faith and justice? Yes. How are we going to do that if we don't believe that God is our only answer? If we don't pray for peace, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, pray for peace within our countries. This idea that we ever were safe from the enemy is hogwash. It is. And politicians use it to make us feel less safe with politician A while we vote for politician B. But what's happening to America is that people have stopped voting. When we pray for justice, we need to pray that people respect our government enough to go and vote. They've given up. And that's what we need to pray about. This can end, but only through faith and hope. So we pray for these prophet-like sayings to come true, of valleys rising up and hills coming down, so that the King of Peace can ride in. The King of Peace did ride in to Jerusalem on the back of a donkey, and the way was made straight for him, and he came straight to the heart of his people. And what happened? It didn't go well. And this is what we think we can get out of, but we can't. This is our fate also. If we have only one life to live, how are we to live it? Praying for one another. Pray for the power to get on our knees, to make ourselves itty-bitty in sight of this wonderful God who can bring us justice and peace, who will come to us again and again as the babe on Christmas night, that we are in charge of carrying that babe in our hearts and protecting that babe. And we are the ones who raise up the plains and lower the mountains through the power of our prayer. Pray for honest politicians. Pray for thoughtful voters. Pray for a country that thinks it's invulnerable, but isn't. We are just like every other country. And we're like Paris. They had no idea that these terrorists were there in San Bernardino. There was no way to prepare for what you don't even see. So we need to pray like we've never prayed before. And we need to grieve with those whose faith is being hijacked. Pray for peace among interreligious neighborhoods and people. Pray that we all know that we're praying to the same God and that we all want the same thing through Jesus Christ our Lord.